Break, you heard President Trump say he wants to get an Obamacare replacement bill passed soon. Now, recall the first effort failed without even getting through the Republican-controlled House. And throughout it all, when asked whether there's a plan B, the White House would say this.
No, there is no plan. I mean, this is, there's plan A and plan A. We're going to get this done.
And so you're confident, 100% confident?
We're going to get it done. That's it, plain and simple.
Well, whatever the White House calls what we're seeing now, it looks a lot like plan B or plan C even. Is it all just an effort to try and save face before the 100-day deadline? Let's get some perspective now from Jeffrey Lord, David Chalian, Gloria Borger, and Paul Begala. Paul, so there wasn't supposed to be a plan B. Clearly, there is now a plan B. The president says he wants to do both health care and keep the government open next week. Is that possible?
No. No, it's not. It's just too much all at once, for one thing. And the health care plan, at least the last one, was desperately unpopular. 56-17 in the Quinnipiac poll, people disapproved of it. When you only get 17% support for something, that's not going to pass. And then when you add to it the funding for the government, which may or may not include defunding Planned Parenthood, which is a deal breaker for the Democrats, I don't see how he does this. I don't see why he needs to do it this way. Why don't you just like slow your roll, bring both parties together and try to find a compromise?
Jeff, I mean, in all honesty, is this just about trying to get some sort of legislative accomplishment in the first 100 days?
I don't know if it's the first 100 days, but I'm sure he's determined to get this done ASAP. And it's interesting when you juxtapose the health care and the government shutdown. We've been talking at other times about how he said that he would cut off the government funding of insurance because he deliberately wanted to force people to the table and force crisis. That would certainly force a crisis if people have got to choose between the government and healthcare, et cetera. That would force them to do something. And I think that there's a lot of impetus right this minute to do something.
Gloria, how much do you think this is about the first 100 days? Because even if it is trying to get some sort of legislative accomplishment, just passing the House on healthcare is not enough, obviously. It then goes to the Senate.
I think it has everything to do with the first 100 days. It has everything to do with the fact that every Republican ran on repeal and replace, and it was issue number one, and they haven't been able to do it. And I also think it's about a president who told people when he came into office, who worked for him, give me some wins. That's what I want. I want some wins. And he hasn't had them. And I think he wants to be able to tout some victories. And I also think if he wants to do tax reform, he needs to get some revenue from his health care reform package. So, you know, I think a lot hinges on this, and I think they know that over at the White House.
Yes. David, I mean, it is hugely politically risky. I mean, it's risky, I guess, not to do anything given all their promises. But, I mean, the last time they set an artificial deadline in health care and put all this, you know, pressure trying to get it done, it failed.
Yeah, I don't think the artificial deadline helps at all. I don't. Mm-hmm. The 100-day mark is just not something I think that the White House really wants to consume itself with, although they do seem consumed by it at the moment. Anderson, you got to remember, absent the win that Gloria is talking about, what it seems the White House wants to show here, because they are the ones pushing this really hard right now, is the effort. If they can't get the win by 100 days, they really want to show the base that they are fighting for repeal and replace because it was a promise, and they want to make sure that the base still stays enthusiastic about Trump because that's what's keeping him at that, you know, 40% mark right now.
But if you want to win, get a win on something that people want. Not something that's only got 17% approval.
The Supreme Court justice.
His base likes that. That was a big win for President Trump. Good for him. I don't support Mr. Gorsuch, Justice Gorsuch, but that was a win, absolutely. But this health care bill, again, only had 17% support. The reporting is that the new bill will allow states to eliminate the pre-existing condition rule. Center for American Progress think tank took a look at that. That means if your pre-existing condition is very serious, like metastatic cancer, your premiums will go up $142,000. If your pre-existing condition is something minor, like a uncomplicated pregnancy, your premiums will only go up $17,000. This is crazy. It's not, even if he passes it, it's not going to be a win. It's going to be a catastrophe for the country and for the Republicans.
It is interesting, Jeff, because pretty much the only specifics President Trump really had, Donald Trump had during the campaign about what the health care bill was going to have, was that pre-existing conditions were going to be covered.
Right. And this is
that would be a big reversal.
Right. You know, first of all, he wants the win. I don't think there's any question about that. what interests me is, you know, again, we've talked about this, that the Republicans had 7 years to get their act together.
Right.
They didn't get it together. Now they are doing it. The House Freedom Caucus is really going out there with the Tuesday Club and all of this kind of thing to talk about these different things individually. It sounds to me like they are getting there. And they will have something, but they are going to have to avoid some of the things that Paul is talking about, or they're going to have a problem.
You know, Anderson, this doesn't happen in a vacuum either, and they've got to next week avert a government shutdown also. So Congress really can't walk and chew gum at the same time. And are you going to have these two huge political fights resolved within a week or two? Doesn't seem realistic to me at all.
I mean, David, when you do look at the details on it, it does seem like there's a lowering of the bar, that they're talking about just trying to get something passed. Wouldn't it be a step towards an accomplishment rather than an actual legislative accomplishment?
I mean, there's no doubt that they do want something that can get to the president's desk and that he could eventually sign. This is not going to be that bill.
Right.
Even if they make the changes to get the 216 in the House, this is not the bill that's going to make the way through the Senate. There's no doubt, you're right, Anderson. The bar was lowered when it completely failed and they had to pull the bill from the floor. And to Gloria's point, you could see today Democrats are starting to step up the fight over government funding. Chuck Schumer's spokesman out there with a statement saying, you know, this is not going to be so easy if the president is demanding border wall funding in the funding bill. So this is going to be a big battle about the sort of shutdown showdown next week. And getting health care done on top of that seems very, very tricky.
Remember that old GE motto, progress is our most important product. This president wants progress.
Yeah, but what he wants and what he can actually deliver are two different things.
Right, but I mean, the pressure is, he is going to put the pressure on these people. And I think, frankly, he's put enough on them already that there is incentive on their part to put pressure on themselves.
Although, Paul, I mean, supposedly was putting a lot of pressure on them before the first time around, and that didn't seem to have the results he wanted.
Right, and they need to take a step back, think about who their voters are. Donald Trump's strongest age cohort were senior citizens, 65 and over. The proposal would end Medicaid as we know it, make it a block grant program. It would no longer be an entitlement. It would be capped by the states. This would hurt older white Trump voters. I'm not for hurting anybody, but it's just bizarre to me that it's as if they don't even understand who their voters are. They seem to be a heat-seeking missile going right at the less educated, less affluent, older people who in fact all voted for Donald Trump. I don't understand it. It doesn't make any political sense.
Paul Bogala, Jeff Lord, David Challey, and Gloria Borger, thanks.